Hi there, Mr. Automation, with part two of ELK Stack. This time we're going to automatically import some data. I'll show the screen, by the way. So automatically import some data in ELK Stack. And the last time I created part one, that was about how to download ELK Stack, how to start it. And I showed you an example on how to import one index with a pattern. So this time, short overview of index and patterns. Index holds the actual data. So that's sort of the CSV file in our example we're going to import. That is the actual data, right? And that comes into the index, so to speak. It's stored there. And then patterns you lay on top of that. And with pattern, you can even include several indices, right? Patterns support wildcards. So that's why you can include several indices. It will make sense when I show it in some time, index patterns are used in dashboards. So it's not the actual index. So if you create an index without an index pattern, you cannot search in it and you cannot use it in a dashboard or anywhere. So be aware of that. So import CSVs automatically. That is what we're going to focus on today. So I have a PowerShell script for that, as you probably already guessed. We're going to download some CSV files with that PowerShell script from a national institution here in the Netherlands about COVID. So some data on the sick persons, people in hospital, intensive care and such. We create a config file for logstash. Then we run a logstash command providing that configuration file and that CSV file, right? And that will import it inside of Elasticsearch. And then we run a REST API command to create a pattern, right? So we can actually search in it. And then we can actually use that data inside of Kibana. I think enough talking, demo. That's nice. That's the most fun part, I think, the demos, right? So we run the script in debug mode and we check the index and patterns after that in Kibana. Okay, let's first go to here, and I think this is an old one. Let me delete this old index for now. It's a big one, by the way. So currently, this is what I have here, right? And I have a script, and I will explain the script a little bit. And the script has some URLs. So those are URLs to this organization, this national institute. I don't know how you need to call it, but I think it's called like that. And they provide us daily with information about COVID, right? And those are in CSV files. What this script does, I'll close this. First, it checks if logstash or Elasticsearch is already running. And in my case, they are running. And if they are running, they open a port, right? TCP port. And if that port is not listening, I'll start up Elasticsearch and Kibana, right? But currently they are running, so I shouldn't be able to enter these lines. So let's run script first. Press F5. We're on the debugger, and now press F10, and you will see that it won't start Elasticsearch because this port is already listening. And the same for Kibana, it won't start Kibana. So the script will continue now. It uses a module. I'll show you in a second what that module does because there is a REST API call in there. Here we set some variables, not really important. Here we loop through the URLs, right? I showed you there all those URLs for each. You loop through them. You get the file name here. You create some variables here locally. We delete the file if it's already on the local file system. And then we actually download that file. Which file? So basically, we have now this first one, this file. That should be downloaded now. So you can, of course, check here in L file, the variable you see that corresponds. If you now press F10, it's actually now downloading the CSV file from the internet to my local machine. And when that completes, we have the file locally, and I'll show that. On the left side, we have now Aantallen, right? This one, this file. We just imported this file or downloaded this file, sorry. What we do now is create a configuration file. And I'll show it a little bit more in depth in the second item in the loop, I think, because then you have a little bit of an understanding what's happening. So you create a configuration file here. It's very important. I create a temporary directory here. I remove the directory if it's already existing. Then we get the configuration file, replace some strings in it, and then we start a command by actually importing it into logstash. And I'll show you what we are going to import. So this C file, this COVID aantallen gemeente per dag, right? It's Dutch, so I cannot translate that. If we look here in indexes, we don't see any index yet with that data, right? If we now run this logstash command, providing this configuration file with the temporary folder, that's what this P is doing. It's created a temporary working directory, temporary directory indeed. And basically that's it. So if we run this command, right, it's now executing. It starts a pipeline now, it's importing data. And if we now go back to our index management here, we refresh it, we will see that we now have this COVID aantallen gemeenten per dag. You will see a count here on the documents, right? It's 9100 currently. If we refresh it, you will see that's now all of a sudden 66,909 and perhaps even more, you see? Now it's 93,000. So yeah, that's counting. So we need to wait until this process finishes. And if this process finishes, then all the data is inside of this index. So I was patient and now we have this file with 140,000, perhaps even more. I didn't refresh it. Yes. So this is now here. And if you open this, you can have a glance at sort of the top level. You see some columns, some sizing. It's not very interesting. That's because you need to have an index pattern to be able to search inside of this index. So now we go back to the script. The script is it's here. It's on the debugger. So now the interesting part comes. So we're going to go to the helper module. I showed you that I import that here, this helpers. .psm1 module, and this in this helpers module we have a new Kibana index pattern, right? I'm calling that here, right? This new Kibana index pattern. And what that does, it's basically creates a JSON here, right? This is a here string. I already gave some videos about here strings, and I provided the index name, and that index name needs to be of lowercase, because you cannot have any uppercases inside of index patterns inside of Kibana. So here we convert that to lower, and then we do an invoke web request. So that's a REST API call. We do a post, right? We're delivering something. And what kind of headers? We deliver some JSON and this body. And that's that body we're delivering there. And if we run this command, we should get an index pattern with the name COVID-19 aantallen gemeenten per dag, right? CSV and then lowercase, of course. So we should get an index like that. And I think, and I already have that because I don't delete the indexes. So let me check on that. So we go to index patterns here on the left side. You see that? So if you have your Kibana here, you go all the way down to stack management, and in stack management you have the index management. We were just inside of this. Now you go to this index patterns, and these patterns you also have these values. I mean, it doesn't matter much for the demo, but you will see that we get probably an error that the index pattern already exists. That doesn't matter because deleting all these index patterns is quite painful, because if you do it from a REST API, not, but I haven't got the code for that yet. Otherwise, you need to click on it here, and then you need to go to this recycling bin and then remove it. And I need to do that for lots of them. As you can see, I have a couple. So I will leave it now for here. So if I run this command, that's using the REST API, and it will create that in index pattern. So I run that now, that command, and now it said the best request, duplicate index pattern. This one already exists. That's okay. That's fine. So if you now go back to Kibana, for instance, you do some discovery, Right? You can now discover that data we just imported. If you know how it was called, of course. Because I have a couple of them here. And let's see, I think it was this one. Yeah. So here you can see the CSV file we just imported is now available there inside of Kibana, right? And it's very important that you have like a sort of timestamp, you know, if you want to draw sort of a report or anything that is based on time, you need to have those timestamps, of course. Most of the time, Kibana will, or Elasticsearch will find it out automatically, but not always. Sometimes you need to help it a little bit. And how do you do that? So for instance, this total reported column here is now of a number field. If you don't tell during the import, automatically import with logstash, what type of field it is, it converts everything basically to a string. I think only dates are accepted as normal date. It somehow parses that correctly, but if it sees a number, it casts it to a string. If it sees a double or a float, it casts it to a string. So that's quite annoying, to be fair. But I did some investigation and you can work around it. So let's go to the next one. And by next one, I mean the next URL. So that will be the second one, this one, the handicapped source, right? So now we go to there and we download that file. You will see that here. You see that file is now popping up here on the left side. You see that we have that file now. And if you see in this file, you have total cases reported, you have a column, total deceased, so people that died that day, that specific day, and you have a number there, right? If you let logstash automatically import this, then everything gets a string. So these numbers get strings, and you'll have a hard time building reports on strings. You cannot count them, for instance, properly. So you cannot do any sum or maximum functions on those. So those need to be integers and you can force that. So what I did, I created a pipeline template configuration. And inside of this template, I have some stuff. So here I replace the part of the actual CSV file we're going to import, right? Needs to be aware of that. I specify the separator here, some default stuff. And then this is important, in the mutate, you have a convert, and inside of this convert, you can convert a specific column name to a specific type, right? So to a string, to an integer, to a float, you see here some floats as well. So you have some possibilities there. The only thing you need to know is the column name. So for instance, this gehandicapter sort of has like a total cases reported column, right? If I looked it up inside of my template file here, you will see that it's there and it's converted to an integer here. If I remove this line and I import it again, that total cases reported won't be an integer but a string. So just be aware of that. It's very important. And that's why I created this template configuration file, and that config file is constructed now. So I'll show you how it works. So here, on line 49, we get the content of this file, right? I'll show you step by step. And then we replace this literal string, parts replacement, right? You see that here, this literal string, that's here. We replace that by a value, and that's the file name to lower. So that's basically the file name we're using now. So this CSV file, this one, this file, but then to a lower case. And what we also do is we replace the index. So we have here inside of this file also an index, and we replace this value also by the file name, but then we replace the backslash by a forward space. And you will see that in a second. And then basically we out that to the file, and then we have that configuration file. So now this is the template, and I show you when we run this command, we actually construct a configuration file here with the same name, CSV file on the left side. If you open this file, you will now see the path and the backslashes being replaced by forward slashes, right? And apart from that, only this index was also added to lowercase because that's only accepted. So now if we run this this following command that's using that configuration file as an input, right here on line 50, right? We run the logstash.bat, and we provided minus f minus file, we provide that configuration file I just showed you here, this configuration file, we're providing that, we're handing that over, and then we specify some pipeline workers and a working directory, and that's it. And if we run this command, and I'll show you that we don't have anything currently, because we don't want to cheat, of course. If we go to index manager, we don't have anything about gehandicapt or so here, right? There's nothing there. So if I run now this command, then it will take some time. So now it's actually connected, and now I think it's also importing. So if we go to here now, refresh it, we should already see something about, you see this gehandicapt sorg, and it has 6,100 entries currently. Perhaps if we refresh it, it will be more, 13,390 now. And we enter the debugger here as well. So what we now have is this gehandicapt sorg.csv index, right, with all the data. If you now continue again, we do the same process again, we create that index pattern again on top, you know, so you will be able to search it. So we do that now, and we generate an error here, of course, because duplicate index pattern, it already exists. This one already exists, and that's fine. So now I removed that file, and now I think you understand the loop, right? It's doing all these URL files. I'm not going to demonstrate that because that's going to be extremely boring, of course. But that is sort of the concept of importing files automatically. And what you can then do after that, and I'll show you a little bit on what I do with the data. For instance, I have this govit.nl. It will be pretty empty because I deleted all the indexes. You know, I only have two CSV files now. So I think most of the reports will be empty, the dashboard. See, no matching indexes, fine. So that's all correct, but there should be some. You see this here, the vaccines is available. Gehandicapt sorg, you see that? I just imported that. So this report is available because the data is also available. And now I will show you, when I run the whole script, I will stop the debugging and I will pause the video as well. When the script is done, we have all the CSV files imported. And you will then see that my dashboard is nicely filled with very useful information about the COVID virus inside of the Netherlands. So I'll continue the script and I will pause the video. And perhaps while the script is running, it's nice to make a little bit of a drawing on how this exactly works. So this blue box is our PowerShell script, right? With some lines here, with some looping and such. And this PowerShell script, I'll take a different color. Let's take yellow. That reaches out to this website somewhere. It's called REVM, right? And get some data from there, that CSV file, and gets it back basically to the PowerShell session, right? That's basically what's happening. You still see it running, by the way, in the background. You see all those imports popping up. And what this PowerShell script is then doing is calling a logstash, right? So it's going to a logstash. So they draw a box here. And that is a logstash. Logstash, right? And we provide that configuration file, right? We, in this side of the script, inside of this PowerShell script, we created this config file dynamically. Config file, we hand that over from the PowerShell to that logstash. Logstash is then connecting basically to Elasticsearch. So that will be E, just for Elasticsearch, right? So that will be imported. And then basically you have on top of that, you have your Kibana, right? So here, that's the K, Kibana. And this is where you get your dashboards and such, like dashboards, reports and such, configuration of the environment. You configure everything there. Config as well. Config. So that's a little bit on a high level. So we have this PowerShell script that runs a logstash command with that configuration file and a reference to the CSV file we have now here, right? Locally on the file system here, sitting on this server here, we have their hard disk, and those CSV files now are downloaded there. Those CSV files then get handed over to logstash, imported into ELK Stack, and then available via Kibana. And if we now perhaps go to this because it's still running in the background, and I refresh this page, perhaps there are some, and let me also change the time frame to a year, something like that. And then you already see I have some information here. So here, for instance, you see the statistics per week on the tested people tested positive in the Netherlands. And perhaps a little bit, you can edit this lens as well. You can, for instance, take bars, if you like that, save and return. You can change time spans. So for instance, if you want to see a trend, so this is the beginning of the COVID outbreak, and then you had some trends here, so some uptrends, some downtrends. And now if you look at the last period here, for instance, you can zoom in. So if you select this time frame, you will actually zoom in into that specific period. And now you will see, for instance, a very flat period here in the summer, right? That was very flat. But now this, for instance, this is quite worrying trend, I think. So if we zoom a little bit more on this, then you see it's like an uptrend. You can again then go to the lens and change that again to a different view, to a line view, for instance. You can change it here to a line as well, right? You have like a line view. But the line view, it's better to have that over a longer period of time. And we'll see you see the trend here as well. It's quite worrying, I think. But that's besides the point, by the way. It was not the scope of the demo. Let's see if we see another index popping up. Yes, so we have here some handicap to sort, some information. We have some information about our Riol, right? we have some information about that, which parts and how much values were found there. So yeah, let's go back to the demo. So I demonstrated that, and still let's wait until all the imports are done, and let's take one more glance at the dashboard after that. This dashboard, let's see if everything is properly populated, and then I think it's the end of the video. Yes, and while it's still importing data, because it's a lot of data, I can show you some information about the hospital, for instance, here. See, amount of people in hospital, amount of people on intensive care. See, and you can zoom into this last part as well, of course, but I just leave it now the way it is. And then here we have some code names. So here you have all the code names of the COVID virus, and now only the Delta one is left over. See that from like the summer, all the others sort of died, and now only we have to deal with the Delta. Interesting information here about our GGD. I don't know how you pronounce that in English. I don't know if they even have that in other countries, but it's something that has to do about healthcare and some control on that. And here you see which regions took the most amount of COVID patients, so to speak. So it's like Rotterdam is the top one, and then Amsterdam. That information is not yet available, so that's nice to see. That's probably still importing. If you go to the hospital intensive care per age, for instance, so I have here a table, and you can see on which, for instance, 70 to 74 people in that age land up the most in the hot hospital. And on the intensive care as well. So you see the green bar is the hospital admission, so the people in hospital. And then the blue bar is the amount of people that land on the intensive care. And these are per age group. Here you have per province, right? The most amounts of people. So here you see that South Holland, and then North Holland, and then, or North Brabant, and then North Holland. That's the order. Amount of people having COVID, and here you see the distribution per province, for instance, in a sort of donut. So that's, for instance, South Holland again. We already saw that here. And here you see North Brabant as well. So those are the top ones, almost responsible for the half of everything in the Netherlands. And then you also see a distribution. So for instance, South Holland, there's a lot more females compared to males. And you see the same trend here in North Brabant and here. So you can North Holland as well, you see that? You see, really can spot some nice trends here in these overviews. This, for instance, is the type of vaccines. So here on the right side, you see COM, that's Pfizer. You have AstraZeneca, you have Janssen, and you have Moderna, right? So those are the four we're only buying here in the Netherlands. So this is an overview that's provided by the World Health Organization and that keep tracks of the vaccines that are purchased per country. So this is the amount of vaccines that were purchased. And I think this is perhaps even for the whole world. I don't know exactly. I think it's only the Netherlands. Doesn't matter. And here for the gehandicaptenzorg, you see that there's a lot of pressure now. You see that's building up as well. You see some trends here as well. So the gehandicaptenzorg, the most problems are in Utrecht. Gehandicapped, by the way, so those are disabled people. I need to call it like that, I think. So now you believe me that these indexes are all popping up. Indices, I mean. And if you now go back to the stack management here, go to index management, we will see a lot of new indexes here. Indices, I mean. As you can see here, and all these files correspond to the URLs we have here, right? And I want to show you one more thing and then I'll stop the video. So index patterns. So now basically I specify a pattern per file, right? Or per index. But what you can also do is create an index pattern. And for instance, I call it COVID-19. I think it was like this. And then on the right side, you will see everything that is included. And you can go a little bit further because you can also do before Antal. And then you see that there's only three included there. So this way you can also play with the patterns and include several data sets inside of one pattern and then create even nicer reports, of course. It's a little bit more complicated, of course, because you need to do some joins here and there. But I just want to show you that there is a possibility there. And then you need to select the timestamp field there because otherwise it will be a mess. I just wanted to show you that you can actually do that. And for instance, let's create this pattern. Let's do that for now. I need to select the timestamp. I don't want to use this filter now. If I can now go back to, for instance, some discovery, and we should now have something like this COVID ant dot, and then this asterisk, right? And this wildcard, I mean. And here you see the data for that. And now we have included three actual indices, I mean, inside of this search pattern. You can then use, and you can use this inside of graphs as well and dashboards and such. Let me check the demo, check the patterns. I showed you the wildcard character. Indeed, you can include several indices. I just showed that. And we did this example already for the COVID-19. I showed you. You can include several indices there or just one. Yes, and now also the PowerShell script finalized. Completed, and now we have all the information here inside of my COVID dashboard here, inside of Kibana. You see the code names, already showed you the amount of deaths is now nicely filled. So you can see it was going up for some time in the beginning and then down and now fluctuating a little bit. And hospital I showed you, and this information not yet available, or I made a mistake, doesn't matter. But this is this is it. So this is how you can properly use your data inside of your indexes, right? Get some value from those CSV files. Okay, that was it. Thanks for watching. Bye.